wonderful you can all be here on this beautiful Saturday afternoon, and that you can spend the afternoon inside with us. Well, you're in for a treat, because I think we have some really amazing presentations in store. My name is Susan Bauer Wu, and I am a professor in the School of Nursing, and I'm delighted to welcome you here now. So the way we're going to do it for the next session, that is a continuation of healthcare and contemplation, is we have two speakers, and the topics are quite different. So what I'm going to do is have the first speaker present and have questions immediately after that pertain to her topic, and to make sure that you have the time to ask her questions. And then we'll go on to our next speaker, which will be Roshi Joan Halifax. So our first presenter is Jane von Godecker. And Jane is a PhD student in the School of Nursing. And she has a background as a clinical nurse, but grew up in India, and is going to be presenting work on a project that she conducted in India using Ayurveda for epilepsy. And this is also the foundation for her dissertation work that she'll begin to talk about. So, welcome, Jane.
Thank you, Susan. Thank you, John, for this opportunity given to me to present my work. And Roshi Joan Halifax, it is such an honor for me to be here with you. My passion and research interest is in the field of epilepsy. The experience of working closely with people with epilepsy has given me an understanding firsthand the difficulties that they go through, the quality of life among people with epilepsy, and the stigma that they face continue to be a problem, alarming problem in different parts of the world. I'm a PhD student, and improving the quality of life among people with epilepsy has led me to decide on my dissertation topic, which is to do a focused ethnography among women with seizures who are not getting appropriate treatment in Kozhikode and Malappuram districts in South India. So as a preparation to my final dissertation, which I'm hoping will happen end of this year, I went to India last year during summer to meet with some of the traditional healers there. So I met and talked with two religious healers, two Ayurvedic healers, and a yoga healer. So this presentation is going to be a report of that project, which I did last year, mainly looking at how Ayurveda helps with people with epilepsy. I would like to start by telling you a story which I heard recently. Jeevati and her mother lives 30 miles outside of New Delhi. She's the youngest in the family. In papers, she's married, but in reality, her mother is her only life support and companion. Jeevati had one child, but he died a few years ago because of diarrhea. She's illiterate and barely has any occupational training. On top of that, she has epilepsy. Few years ago, her husband, who is a bicycle mechanic, upon witnessing a epileptic seizure, beat her up, threw her out of her house, and told her he never wanted to see her again. Since then, she's living with her mother. It was 12 years ago that they found out that she had seizures. Her mother took her to a healer in the local temple, and the diagnosis that this man gave was that she was possessed by an evil spirit. And he said it is so powerful that even he couldn't exorcise it. But thankfully, he didn't ask her to pay for the consultation. 6 years ago, Jeevathi went to district hospital for the first time. There they gave her 3 different types of medications. It was free of charge, but the results were poor because she took the medicines as and how she had free seizures. She eventually decided to stop it because she saw no improvement. When she was taking the medicine, she took, instead of taking 3 medicines a day, she took 1 so that she could stretch it out a bit and could save a trip to the hospital and save money. Now, this story could be true for many women living in India and other developing countries. Epilepsy is everywhere, and so are the problems which come with it. Epilepsy is one of the oldest and most common non-communicable disease, which affects an individual in many ways. A person can have repeated seizures. And when a person has 2 or more unprovoked seizures, that is when the diagnosis of epilepsy is made. Seizures may vary from brief lapse of attention to mild muscle jerks to severe prolonged convulsions. It may affect the way a person feels about himself or herself. It may affect his self-esteem and the relationship with others. Safety is a concern for all of us, but people with epilepsy have to take extra precautions. Seizures can happen at any time and any place. There are concerns regarding harm to the person having seizure directly resulting from falling or loss of consciousness. There can be after effects like burns, fractures, concussions, and other life-threatening issues. It can also affect other people's safety because of the possible accidents that can happen due to seizures. Fear, misunderstanding, discrimination, and social stigma has surrounded epilepsy for centuries together. And people with epilepsy are embarrassed or fearful about their seizures. I have worked here at UVA as an epilepsy coordinator, and I've seen many people have seizures. The first thing I have heard them say when they come out of their seizure is, "I am so sorry." And it's hard to hear that. Patients with epilepsy, especially in developing world, unlike many other medical conditions, have been singled out unfairly from medicine, from religion, from society. They are persecuted and discriminated as being affected by magic, devils, or other supernatural causes. Now, the World Health Organization says that there are around 50 million people who live with epilepsy in the world. They say that 80% of them live in the developing world. India and China, being the most populous countries in the world, contribute to around 20% of their population. And epilepsy has significant economic implications in terms of healthcare need, premature death, and work productivity. In India, epilepsy was found to be the second leading cause, leading neurological disorder, only after vascular headache, both in urban and rural population. The prevalence rate of epilepsy in India is thought to be around 5.3 per 1,000 population. And people suffer in a very bad way in different parts of India. Epilepsy was one of the oldest disorders, or one of the first 8 disorders explained in Ayurveda. Basic concepts surrounding epilepsy in ancient Indian medicine was refined and developed during the Vedic period. in Ayurvedic literature of Charaka Samhita, which was written around 400 BC, is the oldest existing description of a complete Ayurvedic medical system. Epilepsy is described as abhismara, which means loss of consciousness. And the Charaka Samhita contains abundant reference to all aspects of epilepsy, which includes symptomatology, etiology, diagnosis, and treatment. I just want to bring your attention to the poster we have for this conference. And if you see that picture, it's the picture of Nataraja, the statue of Nataraja with his famous Tandava dance. If you look at his whole figure, under his right foot, you will see a dwarf whom he's crushing down. This is abhismara. According to Hindu mythology, it represents ignorance and epilepsy. Mm-hmm. So coming to Ayurveda. Ayurveda is based on the principles of three doshas, which is comprised of five elements, which are fire, water, air, space, and earth. And doshas, which are the life force, are the three fundamental systems of the body, the energy that makes up every individual, and which helps perform different physiological functions. Now, the three types of dosha, vata, pitta, and kapha. The vata contributes to the qualities reflecting that of space and air, and it is it controls the bodily functions associated with movement, like your heartbeat, breathing, blinking, everything is associated with that. Pitta reflects the elements of fire and water, and the energy controls the body's metabolic system. So it includes digestion, absorption, nutrition, and your body's temperature. Kapha dosha is the qualities that reflects the elements of water and earth. And this controls the growth in the body. It supplies water to all body parts, moisturizes the skin, and maintains the immune system. Now, health and disease in an individual generate from balance and disturbance of the doshas respectively. And epilepsy is classified into four types, according to Ayurveda. Three of them being caused by disturbance of each of those doshas. And the fourth type could be a combination of those doshas. The pitta type describes very agitated patient who present with an aura of feeling extremely hot, and then they have extreme thirst, froth coming from their mouth, and they have seizures where they fall down. Vata type, they have prolonged seizures. And in kapha type, the interval between seizures are very long and convulsions can proceed by an aura. The person can feel cold and heavy at that type. The fourth type, which is the combination of doshas, are the most difficult type to treat, and it's the most difficult manifestation also compared to the other types of dosha. The treatment for epilepsy is dependent on these types of doshas. Now, the rest of the slides are about the project that I did there in India. And this is a religious healer whom I met in Kozhikode district. He has been in this field for 33 years. He sees people with all kinds of disorders, any emotional needs, individual needs, family needs. So epilepsy is not, abhismara is not the only thing that he deals with. The most of the patients who come to them with abhismara are people or are children. And he thinks that the cause for abhismara is when a child is suddenly put to sudden surprise, sudden shock, or supernatural causes. And I did refer to an Ayurvedic book, and it does say that psychiatric disorders are due to sudden shock and sudden surprises. Now, what he recommends is prayers, rituals, herbs, and Ayurvedic medicines. there is a certain type of rituals and prayers that they have to do. It depends on the type of manifestation that the child comes with. He does see adults with Abhasmara, but he thinks that if the rituals, the herbs, and the Ayurvedic medicines are not taken in the right way, the child might be seizure-free for some time, but later on can start developing many other disorders, including Abhasmara. So he has remedies for that as well. So basically what he does is give this Ayurvedic medication and herbs, which he thinks helps with the physical and mental strength of the person. If need be, he does refer these patients to other Ayurvedic physicians when things are beyond his control. The Abhasmara Clinic in Kozhikode, I was surprised to see that there is something called Abhasmara Clinic in Kozhikode. Again, they see mainly children, and I was told that it is mainly febrile seizures that are presented in this clinic. They have like 10 to 20 patients with seizures every day coming to them from different parts of the state and the neighboring states. Diagnosis is mainly through history, but they do send people to a neurologist to have an MRI and EEG done just to make sure that they are treating the right cause. They have the man, the elderly man standing there is the father and the other guy is the son. So it is a family tradition for them to treat people with Abhasmara. It is, I was told that the great-great-great-great-grandfather, whoever that was taught by a guru to heal people with epilepsy with certain herbs. And they still continue that tradition. And plus, they have Ayurvedic medicines on board. If you see that shelf on the cupboard behind the old man, those are all Ayurvedic medications that they use. And they also use herbs, which they bring by themselves from different places, make these medicines in their clinic. The type of patients that they see are mainly not real patients with seizures. I mean, they really don't have seizures. Only less than 10% of them have real seizures. And I was told that when I asked them, is it because that we don't have people with epilepsy that they don't come for treatment? This is what he told me. I know of many people who live with seizures and don't come for treatment. They don't go for any treatment. And they feel as if they will face it as it comes. And moreover, there was something very specific that he said. Women tend to be the people who are who doesn't want any treatment. It is basically because of the stigma that is associated with women getting treatment for seizures. The Ayurvedic physicians that I met are from those two hospitals which I have shown here. The Kottakkal Aryavaidyashala is one of the oldest Ayurvedic hospitals in the country, and Kozhikode Ayurvedic Medical College is a newer one. So I met with the physicians in both these places. Ayurveda is considered to be a neuropsychiatric disorder as per them and as per Ayurveda, which is, this is a mental disorder that is attributable to the diseases of the nervous system. They don't find any fresh cases of epilepsy. Everyone goes to allopathic or Western medication first and then come for Ayurvedic treatment when they don't find remedy with allopathic medication. Mainly children are brought to these hospitals, and adults, when they come for seizure treatment, it is mainly men rather than women. And very few are true seizures. Adolescent or young women do come for seizure treatment, but these are pseudo seizures or hysterical seizures, what we call here. Diagnosis, what they do is by detailed history, and an inclusive evaluation of the patient is necessary. Now the treatment, Ayurvedic treatment focuses on individual rather than just on their condition. Purusham Purusham Vikshya, which means character of one person is different from another. So the treatment is also individualized. They start the treatment only after seeing the patient, which is not true in many parts of many other type of treatments in India. You can just tell them what is happening and you can get the medication over-the-counter medications. So, and there are the treatment differ according to the Vata, Pitta, and Kapha manifestation, which I told earlier about. The steps in treatment are in three levels. Deva Vibhasrayam is the first level, which means you respect the person's religious beliefs. So they send, the physician send, if they have such religious beliefs, they are asked to go back to the religious leaders, do the rituals and prayers, whatever they have to do, and then come back to them. This, they say, is important because it reduces the stress level of the patient. And stress is a main triggering factor to cause, to have seizures. The next level is Yukti Vibhasraya, and there is lifestyle changes and medication offered at this time. Now, the treatment, the person can have what is called Panchakarma, which is five therapies. A person need not have all of these therapies for certain seizures. It might be just one therapy from the five therapies that they prescribe. And this depends on the type of seizure that they have according to the doshas. So these are the different types of treatments. Nasya, Vamana, Virechana, and Basti are the main treatments which they prefer for epilepsy treatment. The same type of disturbance can result in different disorders, whereas the same disorder can result from different forms of disturbances. And the physician takes steps to open the channels of the body which is blocked by dosha with these things. This is nasya. In nasya, the medication is instilled through nasal route. Nasya is especially good for kapha treatment, and they say that it will open the channels of brain and help reduce the frequency of seizures. Now you might be wondering why I have the onion picture there. In many parts of India, when a person have seizure, they're made to smell the onion. So I was asking her, is that anywhere related to this nasya treatment? And the answer was, yes, it has an astringent effect and it will help the person regain consciousness. These are the other treatments. Vamana, I don't have pictures for Virechana because it's somewhat similar, and Basti. Now, Vamana is a way to induce vomiting. And it's especially recommended for kapha disorder. It helps improve sleep and reduce excessive sleep. And Virechana is for pitta disorder. Now in Virechana, a person is given herbal medication to induce diarrhea. And it is to remove poisonous toxins from the body. In Basti, a medicated enema is given. And it is, Basti is equivalent to half of the treatment of Ayurveda and highly recommended for people with seizures. So she had an example to give me. There was a man who came with multiple seizures a day. After Basti, he had less than one seizure per month. It reduced drastically after the Basti treatment. So medications. Most of the medications that they use are made with oil and ghee. And they are used for external uses, internal use, massages, baths, and things like that. And it is almost similar to the ketogenic diet which we use here among children with epilepsy. In Ayurveda, it is important that you know how exactly these things work with the allopathic medication. Earlier it was an add-on medication, but now it has a sim- Ayurveda antagonistic effect with Ayurvedic medication. The allopathic medication has an antagonistic effect. The main ingredients which I was told are Brahmi and Shangapushpi, which can reduce the effectiveness of Ayurvedic medication. So what they do is, they reduce the, when a person comes with Ayurvedic allopathic medication on board, they reduce the allopathic medication in 1/4 proportion and introduce Ayurvedic medication in the same way. Other instructions that they give are again dependent on the doshas which they present with. And sleep is considered to be the pillar of life. So they have asked them to avoid sleeplessness. Sleeplessness can cause the initial phases of seizures. And they are asked to eat food that can be easily digested. In Ayurveda, they believe that everything in life has to be digested, not just the food. The experiences of life also has to be digested. That's a very important phenomenon that they follow. Alcohol has to be completely avoided for people with seizures. Now, the outcomes, what did I find out after all these talks with these people? Almost everyone told me that there was a considerable reduction in seizure frequency. But it is mainly with children that they could say that they were seizure-free. Adults, they never came back after, say, 3 years or 5 years. So it was hard for them to say whether it was because they were seizure-free or whether they went to another treatment. So I do understand that there are treatment available through Ayurveda for seizure reduction. But people, especially women, are reluctant in coming forward for treatment. I hope that my next study will help me understand how it is to live with epilepsy as a woman in India and what are the troubles that they go through. Thank you for your time. So we have time for maybe one question?
I'm curious how long this effective treatment has been available in relation to the persistence of stigma.
How long has it been going?
Yeah.
So Ayurvedic medication has been, it's the oldest medicine available. So it is amazing that the stigma still continues. Yeah, it is also because of the beliefs that it is because of supernatural causes. It continues to be so. Changes happen very slowly. So it continues to go on, and we don't know when this will change. But the stigma is there in any country, trust me, even here. Yeah.
So let's give Jane another round of applause. It was a lovely presentation.